wonderful. Now, go ahead. Our Bible is our instruction manual for life. Is that true? I mean, God made us and he gave us an instruction manual in the Bible, and he helps us with that. It's our instruction manual for the workplace as well. It's a place for us to live. And in fact, we're studying the book of Acts. So why don't you turn on your Bibles or turn in your Bibles, whichever way is appropriate for you, or watching at home, grab your Bible and turn into the book of Acts, chapter 8. Jill's going to read a little bit there. But I want you to remember that the book of Acts never finished. It never said, amen, we're done now. In fact, we are living in a new chapter. We're writing a new chapter of the book of Acts now. Acts chapter 29, but we're going to go to Acts chapter 8.
So if you found Acts chapter 8, we're going to start at verse 1. Paul saw of the witnesses, and he agreed completely with the killing of Stephen. A great wave of persecution began that day, sweeping over the church in Jerusalem. And all the believers except the apostles were scattered throughout the regions of Judah and Samaria. Some devout men came and buried Stephen with great mourning. But Saul was going everywhere to destroy the church. He went from house to house, dragging out both men and women to throw them into prison. But the believers who were scattered preached the good news about Jesus everywhere they went.
Isn't that interesting? Wherever they went, they had a purpose from God. My first point, I'll make it easy for those taking notes. God loves to intentionally scatter us. I'll say it again. God loves to intentionally scatter his people to bring about his purposes. Did you catch that? You notice in this portion, it talks about being scattered. When I look at this, my mind goes to Matthew chapter 13. In verse 37, 38, it says this: the Son of God is the farmer who plants the good seed. Actually, it says scatters the good seed. The field is the world. The good seed represents the people of the kingdom, and the weeds are the people who belong to the evil one. Jesus sees you as good seed. Point to your neighbor, tell him, you are good seed. It's all right, you can talk to people. Just tell him, you are good seed, okay? That's God's perspective. He sees you as good seed that can bring about a great harvest. In fact, he'll use many reasons to scatter people. Sometimes people, when we were in the States and pastoring down in Florida, the prices of houses and everything escalated. Costs were going up dramatically, but salaries weren't. So people couldn't even afford to have a house, many of them. So they started to be scattered to other parts of the country. Some went up the coast a ways and started a new church there and allowed God to use them in their scattering out for economic reasons and started a brand new church there. Sometimes it happens like here for persecution. Sometimes it happens because you want a better life for your children. So you move from another land and you move to the place where you feel God has called you. I believe God has brought people into the nation of Canada. He's scattered them from all over the world and he's bringing them to this nation so that he can fulfill his purpose in all of our lives. Do you believe that? Do you believe you're here on assignment from heaven? I believe you are, my friends. When we view it that way, God helps us. Now, in the Greek language that this was originally written in, the word scattered is a Greek word that is diaspiero. I'll move from this monitor so that they don't bug me with feedback. Diaspiero. How many have heard the word diaspora? What does diaspora mean? It really means those who are in one location that are scattered out. When I've gone to the different events around this area, and I went to the, I believe it was Love Africa Awards, They talked about the diaspora of African people that went to Jamaica and the islands and have spread out all around the world. And they look at that as the diaspora. And then when I talk with the Jewish people, they talk about the diaspora where they're spread all around the world. But when I look at it in these verses, I see where God is scattering his people. He scattered the strong believers who were in Jerusalem, and he sent them out to all different parts of the countryside and into the world. by persecution. Is persecution bad? We don't like it. But persecution will push you to do things that you have not done before. It'll cause you to go places where you have not gone before. And when you get there, understand you are there for God's purposes to be fulfilled. And so when we were reading the scripture that Jill said out of verses 1 to 4, you saw about what was happening. They were scattered all over the place. And so God has brought us here. You were scattered and you landed here. Don't be distressed. Be encouraged. God has a purpose for you right here. In fact, even last week, 2 weeks ago, remember we prayed for the team going out to where were they going? New York City.
The Bronx.
Tell us about it.
We went to the Bronx. I learned why I was there, that it is the forgotten borough of New York. Many teams come into the area. They go to Queens. They go to Brooklyn. They even go to Manhattan. But nobody wants to go to the Bronx. Now, personally, I didn't see any different than being in Queens, being in the Bronx. It didn't feel any different to me. But I understand there are a few differences. But, you know, when God puts something in your heart and you gather and God scatters you to that area, you can expect that He has a purpose and that He will fulfill His purpose if you will cooperate with Him. So we've just got a short video to show you. We appreciate you praying for us. God kept us. And we've just got a short video to show you of what we did there.
I woke up this morning, saw a world full of trouble now. I thought, how do we ever get so far down? And how's it ever gonna turn around? So I turned my eyes to heaven. I thought, God, why don't you do something? Well, I just couldn't bear the thought of people living in poverty, children sold into slavery. The thought disgusted me, so I shook my fist at heaven. I said, God, why don't you do something? He said, I did. Yeah. I created you. Now listen. If not us, then
it's time for us to
not allowed to take pictures of the women we were ministering to just for their own safety and security. But you know, when God puts something in together, he is amazing. You know, you saw a lot of faces there maybe that you didn't recognize, because some of them were part of the team from the church we worked with in the Bronx. And what I found the most amazing was we arrived there at 5:30, and at 7:30 we went and we met the women of the shelter. And by 7:30, you would not have known we were two teams coming together. Everybody was walking like they were one team, like we'd known each other for years and years. And only the presence of God can do that. Only the presence of God can melt you together in a few short minutes and just allow his presence to flow. As we walked into that shelter, many of the women were standoffish. Many of them were very hard, and they didn't really want to talk to you. But I tell you, by Saturday afternoon, when those women left after having a total makeover, I tell you, their faces were different. Their hearts were different. And just to make sure, as we were doing the makeover, we had, you know, the makeup station. You saw the hair station on the screen. They had the pedicure station. They had a clothes store. And just to make sure, we also had a prayer station. And we walked the teams through every station. And as they went to the prayer station, the ladies in the prayer station asked them, "Do you know Jesus? Have you accepted Jesus?" And you know, the answers were so wonderful, because women were saying, "I prayed on Thursday night when that lady asked us," or "I did that yesterday," or "Can I do that now?" And some of them didn't even know what they were asking for, but they said, "I don't know about what you're saying, but I want to be like you. Can you help me?" I tell you, when God's presence comes, it changes somebody's life. But the ones that got the most change were we, the ones that went. Were we the ones that went and did it? Because as we were serving them, God's life just opened up inside of us. And God reminded me of many years ago when we were living in northern Alberta, and how God spoke to me and said that I would use you to take women and they will change other women's lives. And at the time, I was living in Cold Lake, Alberta, 3 hours northwest of Edmonton, in the middle of nowhere, at literally the end of the road. If you keep driving, you will be in the lake. And as I was there, I even had trouble believing what God was speaking to me. I knew God's voice, so I knew he was speaking. But I had trouble believing that he could take me from that isolated area and use me in other places. But as I took each step, as I took the steps, as God used me and as God led me in little things, now I find myself in a place. You see, Cold Lake, there were no nations there. It was mostly just people like me. And then occasionally the military would bring people in from other places. I can remember sitting in a coffee shop across from a lady. She was black and I was white. And she said to me, "People just stare at me. Everywhere I go, they stare at me. Nobody wants to talk to me." She said, "I was shocked when you asked me out for coffee. But you see, God had placed the nations in my heart. And I didn't care what color the skin was. I just wanted to share Jesus with people. And I saw a lady that seemed to be lonely. And so I asked her out. And as I was sitting there, I realized that this is what the church is supposed to look like. Just like this church, full of the nations, where people that love God come together and worship him, because he is the true and living God, because he is a good God, because he's a God that has a good plan for your life, a plan for you to succeed in life, a plan for you to touch other people, a plan where he will guide you step by step to be what he wants you to be. And as you are what he wants you to be, as we are what he wants us to be, together we will make a difference for him. And as I was sitting here this morning and as we were singing, I couldn't help but reflect back and think how good God is. Yes. That he took me from Cold Lake and he brought me to Ontario. And then he took me from Ontario to Florida, where I thought I would retire. But here I am, energized by Jesus, with the people of the nations, seeing the word of God fulfilled. So that as we look at these verses, as we study in Acts and see what the church really looks like, we can understand that God wants to use us to touch many people's lives. He wants to use us to change us from the inside out. Jesus on the inside, working on the outside. Oh, what a change in my life. But not just so I can be changed, not so I can be assured of salvation, but so I will take what I have and I will use it to be a blessing, to be scattered wherever he calls me to go.
Thank you, Father. You know, let's keep going down the scripture just a little bit more. Because there's such a, just in the next five verses, four or five verses, it talks about Philip. Philip was one of the servers in the church. He was the one that brought food and clothes to the widows. He was the one that was actively involved, but he also had the Holy Spirit inside of him, strengthening him. It says, Philip, for example, verse 5, went to the city of Samaria, and he told the people there about the Messiah. Crowds listened intently to Philip because they were eager to hear his message and see the miraculous signs he did. Many evil spirits were cast out, screaming as they left their victims, and many who had been paralyzed or lame were healed. What does the last one say? Verse 8 says, so there was great joy in the city. This is what God wants to bring through you, my friends. My second point is this. God's purpose for you involves influencing others for him. God's purpose for you involves influencing others for him. It's not just about you having a good day. It's not just about you succeeding in life and being rich. It's for you to influence others through the life of God on the inside of you. And Philip is such a great example. In fact, the thing is, he went out with a great passion. And when I read about all of the believers, they did not go out into the society around them, relax and just seeing whatever will be. Instead, they went out with a passion from God on the inside of them. They loved the Lord with all their heart, and they were determined to live strong for him, live transparent where others could see the life of God inside of them. That's the book of Acts. Can we live that way today? We're still writing the book of Acts, my friends. We can. I will announce to you, you can live like that. You can live passionately for Jesus everywhere you go, not just inside of a building like this. Wherever you work, children, wherever you play, you can live strong for Jesus. Young people, wherever you find yourself, live strong. Lift up the name of Jesus wherever you are. If you play sports, give praise to him. Don't wait until you're in professional sports and you put your finger up like this to point to him. Live for him now.
Yes.
And watch how you consistently make the difference in the lives of others. And then as they lived passionately, they talked about the person of Jesus Christ. Friends, it's not about your church BCF, even though it's wonderful. We understand that. You have great pastors. Praise God. But it's not about that. It's about lifting up the name of Jesus. Because we'll talk to people from many different walks of life, many different churches, many maybe gurdwaras or mosques, wherever it is. But lift up the name of Jesus. He is with you always. He will never leave you nor forsake you. So as they lifted up the name of Jesus, he demonstrated his love before them. And then care for people. Do you see how we got some P's in here? Passion, person of Jesus. And then pray for people. When you encounter people that have needs, what do? Do you just feel sorry for them? Or do you allow the love of God, the life of God within you, to demonstrate to them that you care as well as God cares? and pray for them. It's not a problem to ask people, do you mind if I pray for you? And you can do it right then, or you can do it and come back and ask them how they're doing another day. So we can pray for people because we care for them. And then fourthly, expect the power of God to be released when you touch other people, when you pray for them, when you let your life touch them. Expect the power of God to be released to touch them. Pastor Harrison brought that scripture out in 1 John chapter 4, verse 17, where as Jesus is he still alive?
Yes.
Where is he? Seated at the right hand of the Father. He holds all power, but he delegated that power to us. So as Jesus is, so are we to be here in our area where we live, where God has put us, where he has scattered us, where he has planted you. That's where we are to make a difference in the lives of others. So pray for people and actually expect results, okay? Expect instantaneous results. And if it doesn't come instantaneously, rejoice in the Lord until it does come. The answer does show itself. Don't give up. Keep encouraging those that need the power of God. And then what do? You live in a way that Jesus lived. Live joyfully. Elbow your neighbor. Wake them up. There's some sleeping out there. Just wake them up and say, live joyfully. Yeah, live joyfully because God wants to change us as he changes others. Now, Jill talked about one opportunity that they took to be scattered into another land. But this isn't the only opportunity that's out there and not the only one we've experienced and not the only one that's coming either.
Last summer, many of our young adults came with us, and we went to Honduras. And we saw God do amazing things in that nation as we joined with 2,000 other missionaries and affected that whole nation for the gospel of Jesus. Recently, Pastor Rick was back in Honduras, and actually, my friend Ruthie, that many of you know, she was down there with a team recently also. And wherever they went, they heard about one nation and how it was changing their nation because of what Jesus was doing in their midst. I want to tell you that we are living in a day where God is moving like never before. He is opening up great and effective doors to the church to enter in. But just like in this scripture, as we read, the verse says, great and effective doors will be open unto you, but great will be the adversary. And the problem is that many Christians look at the adversary instead of looking to Jesus, and so they stay at home and sit on their blessed assurance. But God is calling us to look to Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith, and to step out and to do what he's called us to do, and know that if he has called us, he will make a way, and we can trust him with all our heart and just walk where he's called us to walk. Let me give you one short testimony before we go ahead. When we were in New York, I was talking to this lady in the shelter, and she started to tell me her story. Because you know, everybody has a story. She looked like she didn't belong in the shelter, but she was there. She was a lawyer with a double master's degree. She had a very abusive husband. He had run up huge debt in their name. And then when things got really bad, the creditors started coming to her. They started,
Seizing her assets, yeah.
Seizing all the assets. She was thrown out of her house. She was left with absolutely nothing. They guaranteed her wage, and then her company let her go because she was quite emotional, as you could understand, falling apart, so she wasn't doing her job well. She lost her job. She lost everything, but the thing she lost the most was hope. She lost hope that anything could change and found herself in the shelter. But that weekend, last weekend, God started to work in her heart.
Yes.
God gave her new outfits. Yeah. And she started to feel on the inside and outside like hope and dignity had been restored to her life. And I talked with the director of the shelter, 240 women that the shelter held. 240 women. The director said, nobody's ever come here like this before. Nobody wants to come in here and do what you've done. Will you come back? So I said, yes, we will come back. But if I come back, I've got to bring more women with me. I've got to take more people. And so God started to work in this woman's life because we were willing to go. What if we hadn't gone? What if? There are people waiting for all of us to change their lives.
Yeah.
So back to Honduras. Hallelujah. Honduras was a wonderful time. How many do I have of the team here today? If you were in Honduras, stand up.
Few of you? Great. One of the things that was residual from it, even though literally millions from the what we understand made a commitment to Jesus. Crime in the capital city has gone down 75% in the time frame. See, when righteousness is lifted up, it changes a nation. But I think we have a video report,
don't we? We have a video just to give you a little
just about
clip.
A 3-minute video.
Can a nation be saved in a day? A country changed in a moment? The ancient prophet Isaiah asked this bold question nearly 3,000 years ago. And now, this audacious question has been answered. In late 2011, President Lobo Sosa of Honduras signed a resolution declaring One Nation, One Day a national holiday. He also gave legal authorization and full support for every One Nation, One Day initiative, including free access to the 18 largest stadiums in all 18 states of Honduras. Because of this, the One Nation, One Day team decided to strategically place 18 teams across the entire nation. Our goal was to reach every person in every state. This was an enormous challenge. In order to have face-to-face interaction with every person in Honduras, we would have to assemble the largest missions team in history. Guess what? We did. Over 2,000 missionaries and translators infiltrated virtually every high school in the entire nation. With dramas, one-on-one prayer, and a school-wide call to salvation, we knew that if we were going to change a nation, we would have to start with a generation. Over the course of the week, our One Nation, One Day team inspired over 253,000 students to pursue their dreams and follow Jesus. In the same week, we mobilized hundreds of doctors, dentists, and medical professionals to provide free medical care and medicine to those living in extreme poverty. This group of dedicated people worked hard throughout the week to bring life-saving aid and spiritual healing to the people in need. Along with the medical aid, we also distributed over 2 million meals to over 266,000 impoverished families. The One Nation, One Day team partnered with Samaritan's Feet and distributed 110,000 pairs of shoes to needy children. In order to ensure lasting impact and sustainable discipleship, we worked in cooperation with virtually every local pastor in Honduras. 23,000 pastors and leaders gathered in the largest cities for training events with some of the world's most influential church leaders, like Tommy Barnett, John Bevere, Carrie Jobe, and Miles Monroe. In addition to the pastors' conference, 1,000 of the most influential state and national political leaders, including President Lobo Sosa, gathered in the capital city of Tegucigalpa to attend our One Nation, One Day political conference. All of these events and this historic week-long campaign culminated into one groundbreaking moment that changed the entire nation. On Saturday, July 20th, 487,000 people gathered across 18 different cities and the 18 largest stadiums as the message of the gospel resonated throughout the country. Millions watched or listened on live TV as it aired on every national Honduran station and streamed on over 37 radio stations. And the following morning, the front page of all four Honduran national newspapers read, "We have a new Honduras."
In the new Honduras, we love ourselves, so we discover and complete our purpose. In the new Honduras, we love our children, so we give them education. We love our family, so we pass on our values. In the new Honduras, we love our nation, so we believe in its prosperous future. And Father in heaven,
y Padre en el cielo,
we invite your kingdom to come to the nation of Honduras.
Invitamos tu reino venga a la nación de Honduras.
Can a nation be saved in a day? Yes, it can. One nation, one day.
Praise God.
You see, we can't do it alone, but together we can make a difference for Jesus all over the world. God has blessed Canada. His prosperity is in this land, but his prosperity isn't so we can live nice. His prosperity is so we can take the gospel and touch other nations with his life and his love. So July 20th this year, One Nation, One Day, will be announcing next year's trip, where we will join together with missionaries from all over North America and once again invade a nation to change another nation together for Jesus. We believe right now that it's going to be the nation of Dominican Republic. But you see, they have to work with the government to get the government to cooperate. Sometimes governments don't want to cooperate, but governments that have their hearts open, that want to see their nation changed, we believe the nation of Dominican Republic. I have been there on missions before. I've taken teams in there, and that nation is ready to receive Jesus. And so this next year, we are gathering a team. I believe that we will gather a team of 100 young adults and other people, medical people, that want to come with us and use the skills and gifts God's given them to change a nation for Jesus Christ. Just as the apostles were scattered abroad, God is calling you and I to take what we have and use it for his kingdom, so that we go and touch a nation 1 week out of your life to change a nation for Jesus. I tell you, God is doing wonderful things. But as I said before, the ones that end up getting changed is you and I. God touches our hearts so we are never, ever the same again. It's hard to explain in words what God does inside you. But as God does something inside us, we come home and we're different than we were. We're more hungry for him. We're more interested in influencing others for him. We're looking for people to talk to. You know, our secretary, she was with me one day. She'd been with us for 23 years. She was Randy's secretary. And she was with me one time, and she said to me, "I think you're carrying a sign on your back. Will you please talk to me?" Because everywhere I went, people would come up and talk to me, and they just start talking, and before I knew it, they just say something that I could just share the gospel with. One time I was sitting waiting, and someone came up to me and they said, "Have you ever met that guy Benny Hinn?" And then they start asking me all kinds of questions. Well, you see, I didn't really want to talk about Pastor Benny, but I did want to talk about Jesus, who he talks about. And I was able to, right there in that place, lead that lady to Jesus, so simply. And God wants his life and love to affect our lives so strongly, just like in the early church. Everywhere they went, the Bible says, they were sharing the life of Jesus. And so if you're interested in joining us July 17th for that week, 2015, just send your name to the office, send me an email, call the office, write on your connection card, Dominican or DR, missions, One Nation, One Day, and I'll get the message, and I'll make sure you get the information you need, because God is calling us to change the nations of the world.
Amen. Amen. I want to finish up. The last verses of this whole chapter revolve around divine appointments that the Holy Spirit has for us. We talked about doing things in teams. God will use you that way. But friends, I believe he has divine appointments for each and every one of us. In this portion of scripture, it involved a man who was not serving God, a sorcerer, one who was into witchcraft. And yet God had a divine appointment with him that totally revolutionized his life, turned him around, made him a follower of Jesus, surrendered his life fully, still had to work through some issues, but God used him after, when you read about it later on, you find out God used him as well. And then God brought Peter and John in, and they laid hands on all the believers there, and they were filled with the Holy Spirit and empowered to live for him. And then that Philip that gone in, God sent an angel to him because he had one person, an Ethiopian man, that had been in Jerusalem and now was heading back home. God had a divine appointment for him and was going to use one of his followers by the name of Philip to go talk to one person. Friends, if we'll listen to God, if we will rise up and believe him, he will have divine appointments for us every, at least every week, often every day, and sometimes more than once in a day. And so I want to challenge you with this today. We're going through the book of Acts, not so that we can know more about what the Bible says, but so that we can live it today. So we can live a life filled with the Holy Spirit, empowered by him to do the works of Jesus right where we're living today. That's why we're doing this. That's why we'll be in chapter 9 next week. All the children will be here. We'll be including the children in the message. Some of them will be up on stage with me, helping me. So bring your kids out. It'll be a great time. But I want to challenge us right now. Would you bow your head with me, please? And watching over the internet, would you just turn your heart in towards God? Just turn your heart towards God and listen to him. Because I believe God wants to challenge each and every person within the sound of my voice. So I want to pray. Father, I ask you to touch each person's life, including mine. Help us to recognize so crystal clear that you have a plan for every life. You have a plan for every man, every woman, every young man, every child, every one of us. Lord, you have a plan for every single one of us. And that plan is to surrender our will, our desires, to a God who loves us and knows better what we should do and what we shouldn't do, and is willing to move us around and to refocus us and to help us to be able to accomplish the things that he has for us. So, Lord, that's what we know without a question, without a doubt, that you're here speaking to us as individuals today. And so we ask you, help us. Would you talk to God? Just say, help me, Lord, to surrender my will to you. Help align my life into your plan. Lord, use me to influence other people around me to receive the life, the free gift of eternal life from Jesus himself. Use me, Lord, I pray. Help us to live for you each and every day. And Lord, open our eyes to see ourselves just the way we are. Let us see through the eyes of Jesus, see ourselves. Thank you, Jesus. Keep your head bowed for just a moment. There may be one or two people here today who've never ever asked Jesus to be the Lord of their lives. Perhaps that's you. Maybe you came with a friend or a relative, a family member, and you see the joy in the children and in the adults, and you see you say, wow, that's what I really need. I need to have God's joy inside of me. Thank you, dear Jesus, for helping us. So, friend, if you want to surrender your life to Jesus, I want to lead you in a prayer of surrender. Lift your hand up wherever you are, if that's you. Just if you want to surrender your life to Jesus, don't be shy. Thank you. Is there anyone? I believe there's two or three others. Yes, at least. We want to pray for you. I want to lead you in a prayer of surrender. How can a simple prayer change a life? No, God changes lives. But prayer is our way of communicating with Him and aligning our will consciously with Him. So if you've never asked Jesus, never consciously, never intentionally said, Jesus, I surrender my life to you. I want to give you opportunity today. So one last time, wherever you are, lift your hand up high. I don't want to miss you. Thank you. Would you just stand on your feet right where you are? I'm not going to ask you to come forward today, but I want to pray with you. Just stand where you are on your feet. Thank you. Just stand up. It's all right. We're doing business with God. Thank you. Even young men can do it. It's all right. You can stand up for Jesus. You see, if He says if we will identify ourselves, if we'll stand up for Him publicly, He'll stand up for us before the Father. I'm going to lead you in a prayer. We're all going to join you, but you pray right out loud so you can hear with your own ears, all right? Say, Heavenly Father, thank you for loving me.
Thank you for loving me.
I surrender my life to you.
I surrender my life to you.
Help me to live for you every day.
Help me to live for you.
I ask you to make me a brand new person inside.
I ask you to make me a brand new person.
Change me from the inside out.
Change me from the inside out.
I believe you, Jesus.
I believe you, Jesus.
Died for me.
You died for me.
Rose again.
Rose again.
So that I can have a new life.
That I can have.
And now you're praying for me each day.
Now you're praying for me
to help me live it.
To help me live.
So I will live for you from this day forward.
I will live for you from this day forward.
In Jesus' name.
In Jesus' name.
Amen. Would you put your hands together, please? God bless you, friends. Thank you so much. God bless you. We have a little booklet for you that we want to give you. We want to get your name as well. So would you all pull out that connection card we talked about earlier on in the service? Just pull it out. Look at it. I trust you put your name on the front, but look at the back side as well. Those of you who stood and received prayer, on the right-hand side, it says, I'm interested in accepting Jesus as Lord or Savior. Put a big check mark there. If that was your first time, if you're rededicating your life to Jesus, you can put a check mark in that part as well. And then I want to challenge you to commit to memory that verse, Acts chapter 8 and verse 4, where it talks about being scattered and going everywhere, preaching the gospel. I believe God wants us to understand the purpose He has for our life. When things, it seems scattered around you, you say, why am I here? Understand, you're here on purpose by God to live out a purpose that makes a difference in the lives of others. And then we're going to collect these at the door on the way out. I encourage you to read Acts chapter 9 this week. It won't take you too long at all. And then we're going to look at it next week. If you're here for the first time today, would you join us over just at the side for just a couple moments? There's a welcome center over there. You know, when Pastor Harrison was receiving the offering today, just let me have your attention for a moment. When Pastor Harrison was receiving the offering today, I started to feel something inside. I started to feel that some of you checked out and you were enjoying what he had to say, but you really weren't focusing your attention on saying, Lord, I want to give my very best to you today. And I feel some of you may miss the blessing of God by not hearing His voice and honoring Him in the tithe and in the offering. And so I'm not going to receive a second offering, but what I'm going to tell you is that we have two offering kiosks out in the foyer. And if God's speaking to you, don't leave here without obeying Him. A blessing follows obedience. And so we want to give you that opportunity today. Lots of fun things happening outside. We're going to sing O Canada in a minute. Praise God. So why don't we stand up together? There's some food and things outside. We're going to set these chairs away as well. But let's, if you got a flag, why don't you put it up? You see the Canada flag over here. We've come to this nation on purpose from heaven. I believe God has an assignment for the nation of Canada. And so we want to sing it. It's our choir special today. Would you join them as they sing, please?
Oh, Canada.
Praise God. So I want to encourage you all to enjoy the rest of the time here. And then next week, we're back to our 9 a.m. and our 11 a.m. service. So we will look forward to you again. Remember, the Welcome Center is open and the kiosks in the foyer. God bless you.
Thank you for watching Bramley Christian Fellowship Church. We hope you enjoyed our service.